Alright. Let me just choose. طيب بسم الله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن تمسك بسنته إلى يوم الدين أما بعد فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار. I commence in the name of Allah, the most gracious, the most merciful. I send salutations of prayers and peace upon the finality of prophets and messengers, Muhammad ibn Abdullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, upon his family, his companions, and all who follow him in righteousness until the day of judgment. Beloved brothers and sisters, inshallah ta'ala, as some will come into the room and we have some coming in on Facebook, we are continuing on with our marriage course, and I apologize for not making it last week, but I was sick. Qadar Allahu wa ma sha fa'ala, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala heal all of our brothers and sisters and our people around the world who are sick. Ameen. But we are continuing now looking at the second side of the story that we left off in our third lesson. We had looked at her story, and this was a story about being unfaithful. And now we're looking at the man's story. And as always, we'll read the case and then we'll analyze the case and then we'll open up the floor, inshallah ta'ala, for those who want to comment on the case and partake in, you know, commenting on the case as well. So he goes on to say, the first time I met her, it was obvious that she had the hots for me. The girl was practically drooling over my good looks and kept tottering by with her high heels clicking behind her, just waiting for me to give her the time of day. My boys thought she was the bomb and that I should definitely go over and talk to her. My first instinct was that I didn't do hijabis, girls who wear modest Islamic dress, as they are too high maintenance and too complicated. If I wanted to just talk to a girl and chill with her, there were plenty of other fish in the sea who'd be easier to deal with and who wouldn't get all hypocritically religious on me. I knew my limits, of course, from an Islamic perspective. Other than little flirtation and friendly banter with a couple of girls, I never took things too far. I was shopping after all. Even though I wasn't planning on getting married for quite some time, there really was no harm in pursuing the merchandise before going in for the buy. The way her eyes lit up and her face blushed bright red when I spoke to her made me feel rather heroic for giving her the time and day. I threw out her email after she gave it to me as I walked out of the center. I remember they at the convention, since I had no intention of striking up any more conversations with her. She was nice enough and had a pretty face and a nice figure, but hijabis were kind of like untouchable for me. You don't mess with them until it becomes serious marriage time. Since it was definitely not that time for me, I was going to steer clear of her. A few weeks later, when I'd virtually forgotten all about this chick, I got a friend request from her on Facebook. Always looking to increase my Facebook friends list, I immediately added her on. It didn't mean much to me, yet I could practically feel her beaming on the other side of the screen. I figured, hey, it can't hurt to just chat for a bit. In no time at all, I suddenly found myself actually friends with this girl. I really wasn't planning on it, but I started to enjoy her company. She was funny and refreshingly open and innocent. We hung out between classes on our different campuses and talked about everything under the sun. It was kind of funny how she always wanted to hide as if we were doing something terribly wrong. It really was no big deal though. We were just hanging out as friends. I wish I had just known how psycho her family really was before I even got involved with those bunch of cuckoos. Her uncle caught us just chilling in the coffee shop one day and he went ballistic. Of course, she took off like a lightning rod and hung me out to dry. I got the brunt of his tongue lashing and figured that that was it. Little did I know, the insanity was just getting started. Of all the girls I could have hooked up with at the convention, I had to pick the one with the loony bin household. I swear her whole family was certifiable. After the coffee shop incident, I went home thinking it was no biggie and I just wouldn't see the girl again for a while. I figured a little break would do both of us good and we could strike it up or strike up our friendship again once her family cooled off a bit. Boy, was I ever wrong. That night, her dad came knocking on our door like a raving lunatic. I'd seen the guy before at the mosque and at some community events, and I always steered clear of him because he totally looked like someone you just would not mess with. I opened the door for him that night, and he came stomping in the house with complete disrespect. I do have to hand it to him, though. He seemed to quickly get his anger under control as soon as my mother and my father walked into the room. They greeted him warmly as I anxiously waited for him to explode and start accusing me of doing horrible things with his little girl. The violent eruption I was anticipating never came. After the annoying Egyptian niceties were exchanged for a good half hour, I anxiously tapped my foot on the floor, waiting for my parents to ask what brought this man here at this hour of the night. I was already forming in my mind my defiant denials of anything he might accuse me of. After what seemed like an eternity, the man cleared his throat and began to speak in a serious tone. No sooner had he said, I am here because the computer automated adhan began to call the adhan for the Isha Salah. As much as I enjoyed a little flirtation here and there, I respected my parents too much to want to offend them or disgrace them. I was terrified of their reaction if this man made me out to be a player. He looked pointedly at me and proceeded to provide my parents with a dramatized version of how I had come to him and asked for his daughter's hand in marriage. He continued with his blatant lies by explaining how he and his daughter had accepted my proposal, but felt that they needed to meet with my family before moving forward. My jaw literally dropped to the floor as I listened to this crazy man and his elaborate story. He even started dropping wild figures of meh, dowry, that I had apparently offered and that he supposedly had turned down, since he would not take another step along this path without first speaking to my parents. I knew that this was beyond speechless. I knew that I was beyond speechless by this exchange, but I wasn't sure what they were feeling or thinking at that moment. I could read the hurt on my mother's face since she had not spoken or even taken, or since I had not spoken to her, even taken her with me on this imaginary visit to the bride-to-be's house to propose. My father's expression was one of carefully concealed fury. I wasn't sure who the fury would be directed at, but I had a feeling I was the main target. By backing me into a corner, I could only nod and smile as her father silently challenged me to contradict his claims. I said nothing and just waited for the facade to crumble. My mother rationalized that if I had found the girl I wanted to marry and she was a good Muslim and of Egyptian background as an added bonus, then there was no reason why we shouldn't move forward. My father quickly saw things from her point of view as well, agreeing that in this country, early marriage was the best way to vanguard the virtue of his son and make sure that I steered clear away from any haram temptations. For me, confusion was the best word. I wasn't really sure how I was feeling. I had a few older Muslim friends who'd recently gotten engaged and they seemed to be loving this type of lifestyle. They could go out on actual dates with their fiancés without having to sneak around, and they were finally able to hold hands with a girl. My active imagination made me think of all the things a steady couple could do, and the visions definitely appealed to my romantic sensibilities. After all, my future bride wasn't really to have that. I liked her company, and she wasn't too horrible to look at. That's how I kind of fell into our marriage. Our parents were more than willing to help us out financially until we were able to support ourselves. I dropped out of my engineering program since it seemed pointless to prolong our engagement when I knew I already had a job lined up. From apartment shopping to honeymoon discussions, I was beginning to really like the freedom and independence that came along with this engagement thing. I was sure that marriage would only make things better. After our wedding, which was more of a headache than worth thinking about, we went on the most amazing honeymoon ever. Our honeymoon in the Caribbean was a great way to kick off the season. I mean, marriage. Since my parents' idea of family vacation had always consisted of visiting relatives either in the boondocks of the US or spending a mosquito-infested month in the ghetto village of Egypt. After we had our fill of jet skiing and parasailing on the secluded beaches, we were both eager to start our life together. It felt almost like we were playing house, but without any grown-ups to mess up the game for us. I was starting to grow more and more affectionate of my new wife, and I was confident that our lives were on the right path. We both thanked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for bringing us to this point. It wasn't until we'd been in our apartment for a few days that I finally woke up one morning before she did. My wife was generally an early riser, and by the time I rolled out of bed, she had already been showered, dressed, and in the kitchen preparing breakfast. I turned over and looked at my wife and did a double take. Her dry hair looked frizzy and was stuck to the pillow like the end of a mangled broomstick. Her face looked yellow and pockmarked without a hint of makeup. Her breath reeked horrendously, and she had a small line of drool trickling down the side of her cheek. I turned away from her in repulsion. How could she hide this from me? Was it this tantamount to the ultimate deception? She was like the ugly troll who looked like a princess during the day and transformed into an ogre overnight. She awoke shortly afterwards and didn't seem to notice anything was amiss. Had she gotten so comfortable in our marriage that she didn't think that she was looking like a slob? Even after she showered and straight ironed her hair, which I soon found out was a sneaky trick to making her frizz look presentable, I still felt repulsed by the true meaning, by the true image of her that I couldn't get out of my head. Still, even though I now knew that she was rather ugly underneath her thick sludge of makeup, I didn't intend on holding it against her, subhanAllah. Her sloppy appearance continued as she became more and more comfortable in our marriage. I couldn't stand the messy hair, the reeking morning breath, the shabby way she looked sometimes. Suddenly, all the passion I had once felt towards her was completely drained out of me. It was like a switch has somehow turned off and my affection was turned out with it. The nagging soon followed the slovenly appearance, and her annoying nature started to really get on my nerves. Honestly, the one bright spot during this time was the relief I felt from complaining about her to some of my closest co-workers and friends, both male and female. My wife was no longer the fun-loving woman I had initially married, so I tried to avoid her as much as I could, just so I could be spared by her annoying, "Oh, why did I ever marry you?" look. Several of my non-Muslim friends at work started to tell me about these free online sites where I could look at pretty girls when I was feeling particularly disgusted by my wife, just to get my mojo back up again. I started checking out the sites and clicking link after link to see more and more. I don't think I was doing anything haram. I was just curious to compare, that's all. The more I looked though, the more I realized what my wife was lacking in the appearance department. Just to avoid any issues of unfounded jealousy, I carefully erased the history of my web surfing every single night. Not like she would have noticed anyway. She was always fast asleep by the time I got home, which was another source of her disapproving mommy looks. I worked hard all day while she sat at home and did nothing. I was definitely entitled to an after-work outing with friends every now and then. I didn't need her to start making up rules and curfews for me like my parents used to do. I was a married man and definitely had the right to act like one. Her stupid jealousy started to get really out of hand when she found out that some of my friends at work and outside of work were girls. I really couldn't see what she was getting all upset about. The nature of our life in this country is that we have to interact with members.
of the opposite gender. I mean, if you get a cup of coffee with someone or chat with them late at night, it doesn't mean you're having an affair or anything, right? Of course, coming from such a twisted and strict family, I should have figured that she had strange notions about friendship. Her accusations became more and more ridiculous, and I had all the more reason to avoid our depressing home and hang out with happier people instead. Even though we had our bumps, I was sure our marriage was just fine. After all, my parents had been married for 35 years, and I don't remember ever seeing them having a civil or lighthearted conversation. SubhanAllah. I figured all women just morphed into crazy and ugly old tunts, aunties, as soon as they assumed the role of wife. It should have been just fine with me if she hadn't walked out. It would have been just fine with me if she had just hadn't walked out on our life. She didn't even try to reach out and fix what she had broken. After she left, I kept the apartment and the furniture and continued to live on my own. The life of a divorced bachelor really isn't so bad. I've gotten my freedom and I've gotten my life back. Sometimes, though, late at night, as I'm surfing my favorite sites, I'll think of her. I'll imagine the pretty dimple that used to appear so easily in the cleft of her chin while she was laughing at something I said during our friendship and engagement. Well, I'll miss her voice singing in the house every morning as she more often than not woke up before me to make breakfast. I don't understand why she threw it all away. Anyway, I'm sure it will be her loss, since everyone knows I've done nothing wrong to deserve this type of treatment. Rumors have started in the community with all sorts of reasons as to why she made our marriage fall apart. I just listen quietly and try not to say anything incriminating. After all, I know it's her loss in the end, and it's definitely her loss. And this is the end of that case study. We'll look at briefly, inshallah ta'ala, the commentary made by, brief commentary or summarized commentary made by Faraz Khan and Dr. Shadi al-Masri, inshallah ta'ala, some portions that I chose from it. And Faraz Khan first started out by saying that, you know, marriage is a social contract between two individuals who want to live their life based on love and compassion. There is a commitment, and hard work, or else this marriage becomes a wasteland full of weed, garbage, and toxins, and this is the end result of negligence and misuse. So again, marriage, right, is a social contract between two individuals, and these two individuals, inshallah ta'ala, are taking on a promise in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that we are going to work hard and sacrifice for our marriage, right? And if you work hard and you sacrifice for this marriage, inshallah ta'ala, you'll see the fruits and the benefits of that marriage and the beauty that can come out of that marriage, inshallah ta'ala. But if there is no sacrifice, or if you enter into marriage thinking that there's not going to be some type of sacrifice, then at the end of the day, as Faraz Khan mentions here, you'll find yourself in a wasteland, subhanAllah, right? You'll find yourself in a place where things will become extremely difficult. You'll find yourself in a place where, at the end, more than likely, you'll end up divorced. And he goes on to go, Faraz goes on to say, the Quran declares the role of the husband and the wife, right? And we've mentioned this in our marriage classes, right? That you are a garment for her and she is a garment for you. And we repeat this over and over again, meaning you are a protection, right? Garments help to protect against the climate, and spouses do the same thing, inshallah ta'ala. And that can never, ever leave our minds, right? Especially for the new brothers and sisters who are entering marriage as new couples, you are there to protect one another, to aid one another, to help one another, to help grow together, inshallah ta'ala, not to destroy one another, right? You're not entering this relationship as two enemies who are figuring out, you know, if anybody is probably as old as me, the movie War of the Roses, you know what I mean? Where at the end, they ended up killing each other in the house. They split the house down in half and, you know, they just went to war with each other. And at the end, right, they ended up both dead in the home, subhanAllah, right? We don't want the War of the Roses in our homes, inshallah ta'ala, okay? And Faraz goes on to say, meaning that this is a relationship that will protect, beautify, and honor the spouse. Further, it states, live with them in a good manner, right? And no doubt, he says, that there is a code of conduct for single and married individuals in Islam. However, the Quran sets a limit and advises believers to lower their gaze, okay, and guard their chastity when interacting with the opposite gender. If I had to write a prescription for the unfaithful narrative, this story that we're talking about, this verse alone is full of wisdom and reflection, okay? And we see that the young brother, he had no issues with lowering his gaze. He had no issues with interacting with the opposite gender. And all of this was problems that was brought into the home that he didn't want to understand, right? He didn't comprehend it. He didn't want to comprehend it. And he had an attitude of, it's no big deal, right? Subhanallah. And he, Faraz goes on to say, many people justify their wrong actions and give in to their lower desires. Remember, haram only leads to haram, okay? Haram is only going to lead to haram. Many young people confuse lust for love. And we talked about this, right? We talked about that whole beginning stage and that lusting that's there. It's not that true love just yet, that infatuation that exists that hasn't reached the level of love, right? You are infatuated still. You're blinded by some of this, inshallah ta'ala. But eventually you have to wake up from that slumber, inshallah ta'ala, and realize what you are in. And then Faraz goes on saying, seemingly innocent secret meetings and unbridled romance can be a recipe for disaster, right? What we just mentioned. Postmarital affairs often link back to premarital unsavory behavior. For this reason, it is important to heed Quranic advice of guarding one's glance and modesty. So he's saying oftentimes, right, that postmarital affairs goes back to how these people were living life before marriage, right? How did she come to meet him? She was walking back and forth, strutting back and forth from the conference where he was sitting at, trying to get his attention, right? And then eventually he comes over and he talks to her just to kind of, because he was big and arrogant. And then all of a sudden, now afterwards, he continues this behavior in the marriage itself, right? It was a sign. How you met, how you started, what you encountered, more than likely, this is how that person may be, inshallah ta'ala, right? Subhanallah. And then he says, flirting is often hidden under friendly banter, right? And appears simple fun at first, but can lead to a treacherous path. Modesty is essential to a Muslim life, and the prophetic advice is on the mark. If you feel no shame, then do as you wish, right? This is the prophetic hadith of the Prophet ﷺ. If you feel no shame, then do as you wish, inshallah ta'ala, right? Showing that, you know, it makes no sense for you to try to hide some things. You don't have shame, just go out and do it. SubhanAllah, why? Because if you don't realize that Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala is seeing everything that you do and you have no shame in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, what does it matter in front of the people? The people are not going to judge you at the end of the day. You won't stand Yawmul Qiyamah in front of the people. You're going to be standing in front of the Lord of the worlds, whom you've been doing these things in front of his eyes and his knowledge without a care in the world, right? SubhanAllah, may Allah protect us. Life is never perfect, and marriage is a component of life, right? Life is not perfect, meaning marriage is not going to be perfect either. People get married for many reasons: beauty, wealth, class, education. Life is full of surprises, sometimes good, bad, and ugly. Not surprisingly, whether one finds frizzy hair, a yellow and poke-marked face, a thick sludge of makeup, and downright ugliness, the Quran suggests the way for the believing men and women. If you dislike something in them, it may be that in reality you dislike a thing in which Allah has placed much good. We talked about the story of Zainab and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The Prophet ﷺ divorces Zainab, and Allah sends the angel Jibreel down to the Prophet ﷺ saying, take Zainab back because she fasts and she prays at night, right? Showing that, yes, she may have had some characteristics which were not pleasing to you, Muhammad ﷺ, but ultimately, when you go ahead and start to do your compare and contrast, right, your pros and your cons, you see that the pro of her iman was much more than whatever those negative traits were, inshallah ta'ala, so much so that Allah sent Jibreel to tell Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to take her back, right? And sometimes we get caught up in the little things and we really miss what's important, right? The things that really stand out about our spouse that makes them special, we miss those things. And we push those things to the side because of maybe some little annoying thing that can really, in essence, be overlooked, inshallah ta'ala. And he says, true love shines in marriage when the shimmer wears off. SubhanAllah, I love that statement. Indeed, love conceals all faults, right? So true love shines in marriage when the shimmer wears off, meaning halas, you know, the dating is over, the engagement is over, you know, mashallah, the days of mashallah, hooking yourself up and making yourself look good, inshallah ta'ala, for everything, those days are over. Now you're going to wake up, she may be a little disheveled, he may be a little disheveled, you may wake up to them, you know, bad breath and the likes, inshallah ta'ala. This is part of marriage, inshallah ta'ala, right? And this is where your love begins to take, right, the test of time, whether you're going to go ahead and pass that test and remain together, or whether you're going to falter and break apart because of very little minute things, inshallah ta'ala. He also says, the problem of ugly behavior is much more severe and unpleasant than that of physique, subhanAllah. And the Prophet affirms that in the hadith where he says, surely Allah does not look at your bodies nor your faces, but he looks at your hearts and your actions, right? SubhanAllah. Showing that that iman that lies in the heart is much more important, inshallah ta'ala. And insolence and unkeptness, he mentions, Faraz mentions, is unacceptable, but it can be corrected with proper communication, right? Shouldn't be walking around unkept, right? But you have to communicate. We saw that the brother wasn't communicating whatsoever, inshallah ta'ala. And he says, divorce is usually not an overnight decision, right? It is something that takes time, inshallah ta'ala, right? Dr. Shadi, the portion that I wanted to take from him was where he goes into talking about the whole issue of the khalwa, right? The whole issue of being in private. He begins to talk about, as we mentioned last week, the last lesson, the issue about emails, the issue about Messenger, the issue about WhatsApp, and can all of that be considered khalwa, right? And at some stage, it's considered khalwa. And I like kind of the angle that he goes from, where he begins to talk about sexual relations are unique in that they do not happen in a snap, okay? It takes time. The mood must be set. Both parties must be assuaged, comforted, and comforted into it. It is also unique because one of those things that are in place and it is almost impossible to stop. He says the torrents of emotions and hormones can only be stopped with a violent withdrawal that neither of the two parties are likely to do themselves. This is why Allah says in the Quran, do not come close to zina. La taqrabu zina. Right? Allah doesn't tell you, don't commit zina. He's saying, don't even come close to it. Right? Stay away from it, inshallah ta'ala. Inshallah. Right? Don't do anything that's going to bring you even within, right, footsteps of it, inshallah ta'ala. He didn't say, don't do it. Right? Rather, don't come near it. Once that first step is taken, then the second step will be taken. Then the third step will be taken, inshallah ta'ala. And it is very unlikely that remaining pure is going to happen. He says, chances are slim, right? And he says, the question for us is, would casual emailing bringing unmarried people closer, would casual emailing bring unmarried people closer or not, right? And he says, the answer obvious is, in the narrative above, email was the gateway to entering into khalwa, to entering into that privacy, right? Being alone with that person. And he says, the legal concept of saddul dhira, closing off the means, dictates that the gateway to a wrong must be wrong in itself, right? Whatever is going to lead you into a wrong or take you down into a wrong path, then that thing in itself must be wrong. So we close off that path so that we don't walk down that path. But we should not limit ourselves to just textualism. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in his fairness, created us with our own internal mechanisms of knowing right from wrong. And it is a wireless antenna called the fitra, right? And he says, a man once came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he says, before he could speak, the Prophet asked him a question. You came asking about righteousness, about bir. The man said, yes. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, find it in your heart. Bir, righteousness, find it in your heart. He says, and bir is what you feel good about. Righteousness is those things you feel good about. And he says, and the wrong, al-ithm, is what scratches inside of your chest and what you feel people will know about. SubhanAllah, right? So Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala, he's given us this system within ourselves so that we can know whether we are on the right path or the wrong path. And you know, right? He talked about how when she talked about in her story when they were in the coffee house or when they would be alone, she was nervous, right? She's looking around. She's nervous, right? That was that thing inside of her that Allah placed. You may not be doing the right thing, right? Subhanallah. Okay? If you feel comfortable, sometimes it can mean that you're doing the right thing. And then sometimes it can mean that you're completely lost as well, right? Because like the brother, he'd be like, what's the big deal? Why is she looking around, right? We're not doing anything haram, right? In his mind, he was comfortable. But that's because his faith was not in the right place, right? And we'll go back and look at why am I saying that, inshallah ta'ala. And he says the fitrah is sensitive, right? That innate nature in human beings is sensitive when it is healthy, okay? And this is what we're talking about. Healthy fitrah will bring you to a healthy place. He says, but when the person is righteous and close to God and nature, but when that fitrah is not there or has been corrupted, then subhanAllah, okay? Then the opposite is bound to be true, inshallah ta'ala. So he says, it is important to know that the fitrah can be desensitized, subhanAllah, rather quickly with persistent sin and disobedience, okay? So you can damage your innate nature. And at that point, it is no longer a moral compass, right? It is no longer a moral compass that is going to guide you to Sirat al-Mustaqim, right? But in fact, it may command us to do the opposite. Many people say, I do this or that, but it feels natural. And they therefore conclude that because it feels natural, it must be okay, right? That me, my sin, it feels natural. I'm drinking my beer, it feels natural. I'm smoking my blood, it feels natural. I commit zina, it feels natural. But that person's innate nature, their fitrah, their iman has been damaged, right? They may have ran ala qulubi, right? They may have those black spots upon their hearts. And because of that, they can't see right, subhanAllah. And he says, this logic is wrong because we can only trust our instincts when they are supported by the divine resource, meaning the Quran and the Sunnah, right? So the only time we can say our instinct is right, I feel good, but my feeling of feeling good has to go in line and fall in line with the Quran and the Sunnah, right? I can't say I feel good, but I'm doing what Allah and His Messenger have told me not to do, right? Those are two contradictory actions, okay? So your actions have to be in line, your statements and your actions have to be in line with the Quran and the Sunnah. And when we go back, you know, we look at a little bit or analyze a little bit of the brother's story. He immediately mentions in the beginning, she had the hots for me, right? I don't do hijabis, they're too high maintenance, right? So when we're seeing the boy, he's arrogant, you know, he's one of those young brothers who thinks, mashallah, he's too fly, mashallah, you know, like his, you know, he's the bomb, right? As these are the words he's using, right? As he's talking, so you can tell his age, you know, and Allahu Akbar, this is what is driving him down this path of being ruined. Right. And of course, he didn't do hijabis. Why? Because there is some sense of religiosity behind it. Right. She may be too difficult for me to get to first, second or third base with. Right. Let's be honest. I don't want to do hijabis. Why? Because the religiosity may be there. So if I find me a non-hijabi, in his mind is there's less religiosity. Or maybe even if I find me a non-hijabi who's not Muslim, it's even less after that. Right. Less problematic for him, right? This is what the statement means, unfortunately, subhanAllah. And then he says, you know, there was really no harm in pursuing the merchandise before going in for the buy, right? This isn't Islamic, right? Islamically, we don't go and pursue the merchandise, as we mentioned last week, without bringing the parents, the wali, right? And the responsible parties to the table. And if we make the right steps and we move in the right way, then things happen, you know what I mean, in the right way, inshallah ta'ala. But as soon as we think that, you know, I can pursue the merchandise, and then whenever I feel like it, I can get ahead and buy it. This is not having your cake and eating it too, okay? Islam لا 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 you know تلك حدود الله فلا تقربوها. Those are the limits set by Allah. Do not transgress those limits. And we saw that he really wasn't even interested, right? This was a man, a young man who was just game. And this is what he did. He probably was running around the convention, talking to whatever girls that gave him the time, right? Because we see that she sparked it off, right? He didn't spark it off. She sparked it off. And then he went and he talked to her. And subhanAllah, he says, after she gave me that email address, I threw it out, right? I didn't have any intention of talking to the girl at all or pursuing her at all, subhanAllah. And you could tell that the brother, you know, at the same time, there was a lack of respect for the Muslim women, right? He says, because of the terminology, he says, a few weeks later, when I'd virtually forgotten all about this chick, right? He said, I've forgotten all about this chick, right? As if she's something else, like, you know, she's a Muslim sister. She has rights. Right? SubhanAllah. And you need to fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in regard to those rights, inshallah ta'ala. But it's showing you the mindset of where the young man was, inshallah ta'ala. Also, we see that he had no issues with hanging out. He says, it wasn't really a big deal. We were hanging out as friends, right? In his mind, he wasn't moving this down the line to get married, right? This was something that it was forced upon him, right? He was just chilling. Right? Checking out the merchandise, seeing where it goes, inshallah ta'ala. And if it doesn't go anywhere, inshallah ta'ala, or he sees better merchandise, he moves on. Right? SubhanAllah. And we know again that this is not Islamic. And as he says, I wish I had known just how psycho her family really was before I even ever got involved with a bunch of people. Right? Again, because she came from a family who was religious and wanted to follow religious protocol. SubhanAllah. Okay? SubhanAllah. And then he says, of all the girls I could have hooked up with at the convention, I had to pick the one with Looney Bin household, and I swear her whole family was certified, right? And I can tell you, any religious man, subhanAllah, who may have caught their daughter in that scenario, would have flipped out as well. I probably, as a father, I probably would have came knocking on your door as well. I'll be honest with you, right? I probably would have came knocking at your door, knocking at your parents' door, seeing what is going on, okay? Because this Islamically is not the right step. And you're supposed to be a Muslim, right? You come from a Muslim household, right? So I'm automatically thinking that, you know what you're supposed to be doing, right? So I want to know what's happening. But the mistake that the parents did was that because they wanted to save face for their daughter is that they showed up at the house and the father lied. He says, you know, your son came to my house proposing to my daughter, putting the young man in a position to say, you're going to have to marry my daughter now, brother. La hawla wa la quwwata illa billah, right? Now you force the youth, the young brother and sister into a corner because you don't want to have your family embarrassed. You don't want to embarrass their family, right? But now you take these two young people who are not ready, who are not prepared at all, who have been making mistakes the whole way long, and you haven't done anything to correct and fortify it, inshallah ta'ala, so that they can have something that is healthy. You push them into marriage, as you see that the young boy throughout the conversation, he just remains quiet, right? And he's seeing where it's all going to go. And at one point he says, well, you know, subhanAllah, my friends, you know what I mean, are also getting engaged. And it seems like they're happy, you know, and they don't have to sneak around anymore. And he says, perhaps, you know, this thing appealed to me. It appealed to his romantic sensibilities. Meaning, in his mind, it probably gives me the opportunity to make moves that I wanted to make that I probably wouldn't have been able to make if I didn't get engaged, right? I might as well test the waters and see what happens. SubhanAllah, right? So we're seeing now from every angle how every person, right, involved in this situation were part of the breakdown of this marriage, right? The brother starting off the wrong way, right? Meeting up with the girl, thinking that it was okay. We're just friends. We're flirting. I'm doing my thing. It ain't no harm, no foul. The girl falling in love with this brother. She said that, you know, she thought it was love at first sight, right? SubhanAllah. She's found this handsome man and Allahu Akbar, right? She was head over heels. Then she gets caught in that act. Then the father comes to the house. And now he forces the kid to marry his daughter, subhanAllah, without seeing if the kid is even worth marrying his daughter. I'm giving you my daughter, right? You just don't give your child, your daughter, your Muslim sister to anybody, okay? You, the job of the guardian of the wali is to make sure that this person is compatible, that you help them to see their compatibility, to suggest things to them, premarital counseling, talking, making sure that, you know, when they finally make that decision to get married, that inshallah ta'ala, they made it, you know, with all good intention, and they, mashallah, taken different steps to try to assure that they're going to have some type of a sound, healthy marriage, inshallah ta'ala. You know, and if it doesn't end up being a healthy marriage and it breaks apart later on, لَا قَدَّرَ اللَّهُ وَمَا شَفَعَلَ, then alhamdulillah, that is out of your control. But at least you took the right steps to try to go ahead and make that thing work. And this is why he says, that's how I kind of fell into marriage, right? He didn't really want to get married. That's how I fell into marriage, subhanAllah. The last thing that I wanted to mention, inshallah ta'ala, was that, you know, when he woke up and he saw his wife, and he saw her frizzy hair, and he saw her poked out face, or maybe she has some pimples or whatever it was, inshallah ta'ala. He saw her drooling at the mouth a little bit, whatever it was. And subhanAllah, he found it to be horrendous, right? There are 2 points here. There are 2 points that are very important, inshallah ta'ala. And Islamically, the scholars, this is one of the reasons they say the whole issue with makeup could be a problem. Okay, sisters, I'm just going to keep it real. The whole issue with makeup can be a problem. They call it, the seven scholars say, it is a form of magic, of hiding who you really are, right? You cake up the foundation, you go ahead and put all the color in your eyes, you put the colors in your cheeks, you put the colors on your lips, and really that's not what you look like, okay? That's not what you look like. So now when the brother gets married to you, he's never seen you outside of that. When you wash all of that stuff off, you know, then the real you is there. And we know that subhanAllah, makeup hides a lot of things, right? And this is why ultimately some women use it, because some use it to beautify, some use it to hide defects, or whatever it may be, inshallah ta'ala. And we're not talking about the legality of makeup, the halal, the haram of it, inshallah ta'ala. We're talking about you presenting yourself to a man, and that this issue of this may not be who you are can end up being an issue later on in the relationship, inshallah ta'ala. The second point is that I think the brother was a little bit overboard, okay? And maybe, subhanAllah, he was a bit petty in his description. Of course, what woman is not going to wake up and her hair is going to be all over the place? That's the case with all women. That's the case with men. I wake up, my beard is all over the place as well, right? If I had hair, as a man, my hair would be all over the place as well, inshallah ta'ala. What person wakes up and mashallah, the brother said he drools a little too, right? What person wakes up and their breath don't stink? You know, so I want to meet you. You know, if that's the case, I want to meet you. I want to know what type of blessing Allah gave you that you wake up and your breath smells like roses. This is why toothpaste has made money for decades and will continue to make money for decades. Because we go to sleep, and unfortunately sometimes, and depending on what type of culture we come from, the type of food that we eat, the type of food that is in our gut, right? A lot of the times that brings about bad breath, right? Subhanallah, not a big deal. You're not expecting to wake up in the morning with, mashallah, a rosy breath, inshallah ta'ala. You know, and this is why you go in the morning, you brush your teeth, and then you come and you talk to your spouse, inshallah ta'ala. And if they still have bad breath after that, inshallah ta'ala, then alhamdulillah, communicate with them. Tic Tacs, mints, you know what I mean, gum, you know what I mean, and find out what can be the cause of the problem. Again, the gut is the cause of a lot of problems when it comes to bad breath, inshallah ta'ala. And it can actually be a health issue, right? Subhanallah. So take that into consideration, right? Inshallah ta'ala. And communicate. You know, the issue with the drooling, like the brother mentioned, you know, some people drool. You know, it is what it is, inshallah ta'ala, right? I don't think that was the moment to judge, you know, what his wife looks like. You know, alhamdulillah, before that moment, she always woke up, she took a shower, she got dressed, she got herself pretty. It seemed like she was doing her best to make herself look good for her husband. And then it seemed that she got to a point, like all marriages, right, that after a certain amount of time of being in the marriage, people tend to let go a little bit. You know what I mean? Okay, I'm no longer getting dressed up in the house. I walk around in my PJs. you know, the woman, she throws her head in the bun. You know what I mean? She ain't doing her makeup at that point. You know, these things tend to happen, right? But this is why we mentioned throughout our entire course, communication, communication, communication. Also realizing on both sides that you have to do some type of upkeep with yourself, right? You can't let yourself go. You know, I can't be having, you know, not, I got to get shape up as a man. I got to get a shape up. I got to look good. I got to comb my beard and shout out to her. Why? Because I don't want my wife looking at other men, right? She's a woman. She's a human being. I'm a man. I'm a human being. We all have defects. Let's be real. We all have defects. We all have sins, right? The whole issue of lowering the gaze is a problem with most people, inshallah ta'ala, right? And they see things as they're out there. And unfortunately, like this man, he went back and confided in some non-Muslim friends, some co-workers of his, and they put him onto websites where he can go see women who were much prettier. And then he begins to compare his wife to these women, right? To other Barbie dolls, inshallah ta'ala, who probably as well are dressed with makeup and all the other stuff that he was complaining about with his wife. These other women probably were the same, subhanAllah. But rather than comparing their iman, right, this woman who's now on social media exposing whatever she was exposing of herself, has no faith, right? That's the type of woman you want versus the one you have in your house that has iman. And maybe she's not the most beautiful thing in the world, but subhanAllah, it didn't seem like she was ugly as well either, because he's mentioned she wasn't half bad, right? SubhanAllah, right? So you see that, you know, subhanAllah, his desires were just kind of maneuvering him and moving him into a wrong place, inshallah ta'ala. And lastly, you know, the whole issue of, I work all day, I should be able to go out with my friends and hang out. You know, my wife stays home, she does nothing. Listen, sitting at home is work. She was servicing the household, right? Cooking, washing dishes, cleaning clothes, taking care of children, right? Making sure when you come home, you're happy that you're going to have a smile on your face, your house is smelling good. You know what I mean? That's work. That's work, brother. You know, it takes work and effort, you know what I mean, to maintain a house. You know, you can't downplay her effort and her hard work and her sacrifice as she does nothing, right? So, you know, because I work hard, I'm going to go out and chill and hang out with my friends. That's a recipe for disaster. That's a recipe for disaster in any relationship. Wallahi, you know, when you start going out with your friends and she starts going out with her friends, and subhanAllah, you know, this becomes a regular practice in the house, it's a recipe for disaster. You know, it's a recipe to fornication and adultery. It's a recipe to, you know, having issues between each other. It's a recipe to bring shaitan in and begin to think, yo, who's he with or who she's with? Why are they out all of the time? Are you seeing somebody else? You know, what's going on? Who you found in that club? It's a problem, right? These things become a problem, inshallah ta'ala, unfortunately. And we really need to make sure that we get that under wraps, inshallah ta'ala, that when you get married, inshallah ta'ala, that is your focus. Your family is your focus. You know, your friends aren't your focus anymore. Your family is your focus, inshallah ta'ala. And your friends, you go out and do things with them every now and then, the men with the men, the women with the women, but that's not all the time. And then sometimes you figure out how you can do things as maybe couples with other friends who are married as well, with them and their wives, inshallah ta'ala. So that alhamdulillah, you create a wholesome, mashallah, relationship with your wife and a wholesome relationship with how you deal with the people who are around you, inshallah ta'ala. And he, as he mentioned, her stupid jealousy started to get really out of hand. What would you think? He's talking about, it is okay for me to go out with coworkers who are women at night, sit down, drink coffee, and whatever else it was that you do. Imagine now we put the shoe on the other foot. If it was her going out at night with men, how would he have felt? Right? Oftentimes, we don't want to put the shoe on the other foot, right? SubhanAllah. So we have to put the shoe on the other foot and think about that. Yes, of course. You know what I mean? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has already made it impermissible for you to be with a woman alone in khalwa, let alone now that you're a married man with another woman in khalwa who's not your wife, right? That's an even bigger problem, inshallah ta'ala, that definitely was going to ruin the marriage. And lastly, I know I said lastly like three times, he mentioned that, you know, after all, my parents had been married for 35 years and I don't remember ever seeing them having a civil or lighthearted conversation. And this hurt me, right? When I read this, you know, it bothered me because as parents, we are examples for our children, right? And what marriage may look like, inshallah ta'ala. And if they don't see that there's love between us in the home, if they don't see that, you know, we love each other, we hug each other, we play with each other, we joke with each other, you know, of course they're going to see the bad as well sometimes. But I always, like I mentioned before in marriage courses, when they see the bad, you have to let them see the good as well, right? They should, if they see the argument, they should see the makeup, right? They should know that, mashallah, you know how to make up, you know how to talk, you know how to communicate, you know how to get past your problems, even though you should try to avoid your kids seeing you argue and scream and yell at one another, mashallah. But if it happens that they do see it, then they should see the makeup on the other side. And they should see the good side of, you know what I mean, of the marriage as well, inshallah ta'ala. The last thing you want to be is that, you know, example of what a marriage is not supposed to be like, right? So we see here this young man, he had in his mind, well, you know, this is what marriage is supposed to be like anyway. You know what I mean? I'm not going to get along with my wife. She's going to be some ugly auntie in the community. You know, it is what it is. You know, subhanAllah, wa lillahi alhamd. You know, Allahu Akbar. So we want, inshallah ta'ala, you know, to benefit from all of this, inshallah ta'ala. I know it's a lot to take in, and I kind of, you know, combined two lessons in one, inshallah ta'ala. So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept. And again, the floor is open for anyone to comment, inshallah ta'ala, share experiences, ask questions. You can open up your mic. You can send it in the chat, inshallah ta'ala. You can send it on Facebook if you're on Facebook and joining us on Facebook. And inshallah ta'ala, we can move forward from there, inshallah. So we have a hadith that was given here by our brother Omar. In the authority of An-Nawas Ibn Sam'an, may Allah be pleased with him, that the Prophet said, righteousness is in good character, and wrongdoing is that which wavers in your soul, and which you dislike the people finding out about. Now, Muslim. This is one of the hadiths that we're talking about. In the authority of Wasiba Ibn Ma'bad, radiyallahu anhu, who said, I came to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, you have come to ask about righteousness. And he's putting the hadith here. I said, yes. He sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, consult your heart. Righteousness is that about which your soul feels at ease and the heart feels tranquil, and wrongdoing is that which wavers in the soul and causes uneasiness in the breast, even though people have repeatedly given their legal opinion in its favor. So alhamdulillah, these hadith, he put it here, inshallah ta'ala, so that we can benefit from it. And then he gives us an ayah in the Quran, Surah Anfal, ayah 29. O believers, if you are mindful of Allah, he will grant you a standard to distinguish between right and wrong, absolve you of your sins, and forgive you. And Allah is the Lord of infinite bounty. Now, mashallah, beautiful ayah in the Quran, meaning that if you are people of taqwa, inshallah ta'ala, inshallah, and belief, then inshallah ta'ala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give you that thing to help to guide you, inshallah ta'ala. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless you for sharing those beautiful ahadith and that ayat with us, brother Omar, inshallah. Anyone else? It's the summer, I don't want to throw you under the bus. Anything you want to add? I see you're in here with us, inshallah. I don't see anything on Facebook. Jazakallah khair, sister Sama. Allah accept, inshallah ta'ala. Barakallahu fik, inshallah. And alhamdulillah, brothers and sisters, you know, next week, inshallah ta'ala, on the 16th, inshallah, we are having our program at Ibn Sina, and we want to invite all of you brothers and sisters to it, inshallah ta'ala. And it is titled, How to Keep a Marriage Full, right? And this is an important topic that we are going to be discussing, inshallah ta'ala, and the journey from the self to a relationship, and how to create a relationship that lasts. And alhamdulillah, we're going to have Sister Summer and Sister Ru'a, who are going to be, mashallah, putting together a little workshop for us, inshallah ta'ala, where we can have interaction, alhamdulillah. So definitely, you know, we invite you all out to that, to join us on that day. The food will be served, inshallah. We'll have dinner provided for us. Alhamdulillah, great dialogue, great conversation, great presentations, inshallah ta'ala. And all of this, inshallah ta'ala, so that inshallah we can have healthy marriages and for those who are not married, so that inshallah ta'ala, you know how to build a healthy marriage inshallah in the future, and so that our kids ultimately see what a healthy marriage is about, and inshallah ta'ala, they grow up seeing that. And I have to stress that point, you know, I grew up in a broken home. My mother and my father divorced by the time I was 10 years old. And I can remember the pain and the drama that that caused in my life, right? SubhanAllah. And how it affected my education, how it affected my childhood, how it affected decision-making in my life, how it affected my treatment of women. I'll be honest, right? How it affected my treatment and how I thought about women at one point in my life, you know, SubhanAllah. So we really need to know that how we behave in the home in front of our children, we're either being a beautiful example or we can be very destructive in that child's life, inshallah ta'ala, because these things tend to play out later on for them in their life. And alhamdulillah, we can only thank Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala and mashallah be grateful that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has helped to save us and remove us from some of that stuff, inshallah ta'ala. And no doubt that all every one of us still has much work to do, right? We all have work to do in some area, some form, some fashion. But alhamdulillah, as long as we continue to work on ourselves and as long as we present ourselves to Allah as we're broken and asking Allah to help fix us and repair us and guide our hearts, that subhanAllah, you know, Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala will, mashallah, help to guide us to what is always right. And then Sister Summer, she writes here, she says, just like both individuals and unfaithful were both not taught the proper ways of growing as a couple and building the foundations of the relationship, our workshop will stress on this topic as well. Mashallah, mashallah. So alhamdulillah, it's going to be an excellent workshop. Again, don't miss it, inshallah ta'ala, October 16th, 6 p.m., Mass Ibn Sina Center in Queens, inshallah ta'ala. You can visit our Facebook page, Mass New York Rewards Reconnect, and you'll find the events page there. You'll find the flyer there, inshallah ta'ala. If you can't find it, you can go ahead and reach out to us at rewardsreconnect@massnewyork.org, and inshallah ta'ala, we can send you all of the information. There is a pre-registration out there. We ask everyone to please pre-register so that way we know how many people are showing up, we know how many people are set up for, we know how much food to buy. All of this is important for a good outcome and a good program, inshallah ta'ala. With that, brothers and sisters, if no one has anything else to add or say or any questions, then we ask Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala to make us from those who have healthy marriages. And if we're not married, to make us from those, inshallah ta'ala, who take healthy steps towards having healthy marriages, inshallah ta'ala. And that all begins with knowledge, inshallah ta'ala, and sincerity. And we ask Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala to accept all of our efforts and to ultimately allow him to be first in our life. And if he's first in our life, then inshallah ta'ala, we'll always be walking down the sirat that is straight and following and remaining within the limits that he has set. Ameen. Jazakumallahu khairan. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. And we'll see you all tomorrow, inshallah ta'ala, for alhamdulillah, our book club at 8 p.m. Women Around the Messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.